chapter 11, 1 through 10. A shoot shall come up from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the lion, and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put his hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea.
We've been sitting for a little while. I'm going to invite you to rise for the reading of the New Testament. This is also a way that we show our reverence for God's Word. I'll be reading from the Apostle Paul's letter to the church in Rome, chapter 15, verses 4 through 12. Let's hear God's Word. For whatever was written in our former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and by the encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope. May the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Christ Jesus, so that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome one another, therefore, just as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the circumcised on behalf of the truth of God, in order that he might confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will confess you among the Gentiles and sing praises to your name. And again he said, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles. And let all of the peoples praise him. And again, Isaiah says, the root of Jesse shall come, the one who rises to rule the Gentiles. In him, the Gentiles shall hope. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And you may find your seat. Have you ever been down in a crawl space? The crawl space, of course, is that rather unremarkable space that exists as something of a purgatory between the earth and the first level of your house. They're great to store stuff in, and yet they are no fun to try to get around in, are they? The floor, of course, is all dirt. There is no lights in most crawl spaces, and your only company is usually dead cockroaches and worse. Personally, I'm always afraid that I'm going to find a dead body in the crawl space. I don't know, I've just watched one too many CSI episodes, but they're right. If you're going to stick a dead body anywhere, you're going to stick it in that crawl space. I know. Well, anyway, one Christmas, I was down in the crawl space having to lay some speaker wire for some speakers in our home. And so, after convincing myself that the previous owner's seemed like they were good people and that they probably didn't kill anybody and stick the body down there. Put on my cruddiest jeans, I grabbed my flashlight, and I began crawling around in the dirt down there, trying not to bonk my head on the low ceiling. Well, while I was down there in the crawl space, an interesting thing happened to me. I discovered that I could hear pretty much everything that was going on up above me, although in muted tunes. My in-laws, for instance, were in town, and I found that I could hear them and my wife, Rebecca, upstairs walking around and talking to one another. They sounded happy. And I wish that I could have been up there with them. And then Rebecca started playing Christmas carols on the piano. Silent night, holy night. It would have been enjoyable had I not been in all of that dirt with a sore back and, of course, dead bodies lurking around every corner. I wanted to join the party upstairs, and yet I had work that I had to do down there in that crawl space. I wonder how many of us this Advent, this Christmas season, feel a bit like we're down in the crawl space. We can hear the joyful music going on around us. We can hear the happy conversations, and we would love to join in. And yet, we simply are not able because we too have some work that we have to do down there in the crawl space. Some of us, for instance, have work to do in the area of grieving. We don't want to, and yet seeing all of the merriment around us reminds us of those loved ones in our lives who used to be there, but who are no longer there. We remember our spouses, our parents, our friends, or our children who used to be with us but were no longer there. Maybe they have passed away, or maybe they have moved away. And yet we remember their presence in our lives, especially acutely during this holiday season. And we feel the stab of pain when we think of it. Others of us may be down in the crawl space for the opposite reason. We have our families, and yet we're dreading spending time with them during the holiday season, fearing the recreation of old dysfunctional patterns down in the crawl space. But the good news this morning is that there is hope for you and for those around you who are down in the crawl space this Christmas. Because it was to broken-hearted folks down in the crawl space of life that Isaiah chapter 11 was written. Isaiah, most scholars would say, is writing to the Israelites in exile. They remembered the promise of 2 Samuel 7 that said that God would always have a king from David's lineage on the throne of Israel. And yet they had just gone through this terrible experience of watching each of the sons of King Zedekiah being put to death, and then watching him being blinded and carried off in shame to Babylon. By the rivers of Babylon, they wrote in their hymnal, there we sat down and there we wept when we remembered Zion. On our willows there we hung up our hearts, for how could we sing the songs of the Lord in a foreign land? Like many of us, the Israelites were down in the cross. And yet, light dawns precisely on those who are in the darkness. This week in our disciple class, for instance, we were talking about Job and how Job could not reimagine, could not think of God in new ways until Job's life was disoriented and thrown into turmoil. When our lives are comfortable, like we were talking about with our kids, When our lives are comfortable, it's almost impossible for us to hear God's word coming to us. And yet when we are in disarray, when we are disoriented, God's word comes to us. Out of the silence of our suffering, God speaks. Now to Isaiah, God's word came in the form of a promise of a new king. The royal line of David, he said, is like a tree stump that has been cut down. But just as a new shoot will come up out of a tree stump, he says, so a new king will arise out of David's family. And what a glorious king he will be, according to Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord will give him wisdom and strength, so that he will be an effective counselor and a powerful leader. He will be given the fear of God, so that he will be an effective spiritual leader. What a hopeful word this must have been for the exiled Jews. And yet, a word of hope that is only to Jewish people wouldn't be of much hope or help to Gentiles like you and me, would it? And so verse 10 in Isaiah 11 says that the nations, the goyim, that is the uncircumcised like us, that we will gather in Jerusalem and that we will honor the new king along with the people of Israel. Now that may not seem like a big idea or a big deal to you and I, and yet this idea of the Gentiles being included in God's covenant of grace was radical in its day. It was a promise that went unfulfilled for hundreds and hundreds of years until a tiny baby was born to a dirt poor 14-year-old girl in a backwoods land called Bethlehem. For it is in the advent of Jesus Christ that this promise has been fulfilled. Which, of course, is why the Apostle Paul quotes Isaiah chapter 11, verse 10 in our New Testament reading from the book of Romans. As Paul puts it, God has confirmed his promises given to the patriarchs in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. He who rises to rule the Gentiles, in him shall the Gentiles hope. There is hope for all of us, even when we're down in the crawlspace. Hope not that our depression will magically lift itself, or our funk or the blues will somehow instantaneously evaporate, but rather hope based upon the fact that God is a promise-keeping God. Christian hope, you see, is neither Pollyanna optimism nor wishful thinking. Rather, it is rooted in the promise and in the experience that God is faithful and that light shall come upon us once again. When we least expect it and most need it, God's love will break through our lives. Romans 15 details at least three different ways that we can experience this hope. The first is in Scripture. Verse 4 says that whatever was written in the former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope. One of the first ways we gain hope in our lives is by exposing ourselves to God's Word, by meditating upon Holy Scripture and pondering how God has worked in other people's lives and how God can still work in our lives. It is in Scripture that we are told that we can do all things through Christ Jesus, is it not? It is in Scripture that we are told that our sins are forgiven and that we can be as white as snow. We read in Scripture that God is with us, even to the ends of the age. It is in Scripture that we are assured of God's love, even when we feel quite unlovable. And it is in Scripture that we find people, other people, spiritual people, godly people, Crawlspace with us. Did you know, for instance, that nearly one-third of the Psalms are hymn book, basically, scripturally? That nearly one-third of those Psalms are written by people that we would probably define as clinically depressed today. I don't know about you, but I find that kind of a strange, kind of a comforting good news. Because it says that I'm not alone, and it says that I'm not unspiritual for feeling depressed or having the blues. Because God's people have felt this way and struggled with this disease for a long time. And by reading about those folks who are depressed, we learn how they dealt with their depression and how eventually they found a way through it. And that's why I placed a list of those one-third of the Psalms that are depressed on the church information table in the back there. I'd encourage you to take it home and check out some of those Psalms that were written by people who were done with Crawlspace. A second source of hope, according to Romans 15, is living in harmony with one another. Depression, the blues, thrives in isolation. And yet the Bible encourages us to live in community with other people. When we are feeling down, it is especially critical that we put ourselves in places where we will interact with other people, as hard as that may be, and that we let those people love us right where we are. We need to talk about our sadness and about our grief, even when we're afraid that our friends may perhaps be tired of hearing about it. Chances are they aren't. And even if they are, good friends will stick with you through thick and through thin. Allow them, would you please, the privilege of loving you just as you have loved them when they have been down. Allow others to come into your life. Final source of hope, according to Romans 15, is the welcoming grace of Jesus Christ. Welcome one another, as Christ has welcomed you, we read in verse 7. The Greek word used there for welcoming literally means to draw to one's self, to find somebody who is afar off and bring them close to yourself. As Christ has drawn us close to himself, so we are to draw others to ourselves. Christ's acceptance is the foundation of our acceptance of other people. Christ's grace is the foundation of our ability to give grace to other people. As wood fuels a fire and warms those that are gathered around, so grace fuels our ability to welcome other people, especially those who are different than us, and makes it possible for us to warm their hearts and their lives also. Grace, as theologian Paul Tillich, strikes us when we are in great pain and restlessness. It strikes us when we walk through the dark valley of a meaningless and empty life. Grace strikes us when our disgust for our own being, our indifference, our weakness, our hostility, and our lack of direction and composure have become intolerable even to us. Sometimes at that moment, a wave of light breaks into our darkness. And it is as though a voice were saying, you are accepted. You are accepted by that which is greater than yourself. Do not seek for anything. Do not perform anything. Do not intend to do anything. Simply accept the fact that you are accepted. Have you accepted the fact in your own life that you are accepted in Christ Jesus, even if you are down in the crawl space of life? You know, friends, there is nothing that you can do in your life that will make God love you anymore. Did you ever think about that? And there is nothing that you can do in your life that will ever make God love you any less. You simply are loved. We are simply loved. And we need to live day in and day out into that love. And so we come to this table, which is the supreme expression of God's grace and acceptance and welcoming. We've talked about many of the opportunities that we will have during Advent to experience God's grace coming into our lives through Scripture, through community, and so on and so forth. And yet, nowhere is God's grace more evident than right here at this table. For here, God's love has crossed the chasm that separates heaven and earth and come to us in a way that we can understand. Here, God's love has broken through all time and through all space and has come close to us, as close as the cup, as close as the bread. And that, dear friends, is exactly the promise of Advent, that God has come close in the babe of Bethlehem, and that he will draw close again wherever humble hearts will receive him. He comes whether we are joyful. He comes whether we are in the crawlspace of life. And so we come to this table in hope. And so we come to this table expectantly. Let's pray. Gracious God, we live in this society that is so overhyped around this time of year, which only makes our pain and our sorrow and our depression all the more acute because we feel like we're the only ones who are down and out. Thank you, God, for your word which comes to us and which reassures us that it is natural and it is normal. And yeah, maybe in many circumstances it's healthy for us to be down there in the crawl space, and we simply have work to do down there. Remind us, God, that when we're down there, that we're not alone. That you are Emmanuel, God with us. And that you come and you enter into the midst of our pain and of our sorrow, of our grief. And that you reassure us of your presence. Help us to hear your voice yet again as we come to this holy feast in Jesus' name.